be reading a statement, after which you'll be taking questions. Yes?
Good morning, everyone. The statement reads as follows. The People's Progressive Party calls on the diplomatic community in Guyana to pay close attention to the upcoming local government elections scheduled to be held on March 18, 2016. The party has noted the contribution and offers made to GCOM by the donor community resident in Guyana. In this respect, Canada and India have already made significant contributions to GCOM, with India contributing $8.3 million and Canada 20,000 Canadian. These contributions are viewed by the party as investments in the democratic grassroots governance process. In this respect, the party is of the view that it behoves the donor community to ensure that the local government election produces greater inclusion, civic responsibility, empowerment, and participation on the part of the electorate in the 71 local authority areas where elections are scheduled to be held. The party wishes to draw to the attention of the diplomatic community that all is not well at GCOM, since there has been no improvements whatever in the policy, administration, nor operational levels of the organization. The intransigence on the part of the chairman, the chief elections officer, and the three commissioners representing the APNU AFC continues to prevail, notwithstanding the convincing and evidence-based submissions made by Messrs. Ben, Shadiq, and Gunraj, as well as those made by the PVPC delegations, which met from time to time with the commission. The party urges the diplomatic community to view with skepticism statements made by the Deputy Chief Elections Officer, Mr. Vishnu Prasad, who in a letter published in the Kaicho News of January 4, 2016, stated, "Guyana can look forward to fair local government elections," quote unquote. The PVP views this statement as extremely puzzling, if not disturbing, especially in light of a subsequent statement made on January 19, 2016, and made 2 weeks after his deputy had spoken. In a statement, Mr. Keith Lowenfield, GCOM's chief executive officer, had declared that GCOM has, quote, a shortfall in the number of election day staff, notwithstanding several advertisements which did not attract the requisite number of suitably qualified persons to fill existing vacant positions. These include presiding officers, assistant presiding officers, poll clerks, etc. In this connection, the PVP wishes to remind the diplomatic community of its view that the hiring of GCOM staff in general for elections and for Election Day in particular lacks transparency. Clearly, staffers at GCOM are not hired on the basis of merit. Moreover, it appears from the composition of the staff that 95% of the persons are of one race, and they're the ones who usually would pass the exams set by GCOM. Further, neither has GCOM, the Ministry of the Presidency, the Ministry of Citizenship, nor the Ministry of Communities refuted the claim that a conspiracy is being hatched to issue underage persons with false birth certificates and to facilitate persons who are resident in a constituency where there will be no local government elections to vote in those constituencies where local government elections will take place. Elections observers are advised to keep a close watch on the process where alpha splits would be used to determine the number of polling stations to be used and the number of electors that will be allowed to vote at those polling stations. The party has also raised its concerns and reservations with respect to voting by the disciplined forces, which, from all indications, is infested with a host of complications which GCOM refuses to recognize and to accept, notwithstanding persistent representations made by the PPP. The party has taken note of GCOM's Deputy Chief Executive Officer's quote-unquote frustration at the party's quote-unquote complaints and wishes to advise Mr. Prasad that the PPPC is a major political stakeholder in the elections process in this country, and it has an obligation, nay, a duty, to its constituents, and indeed the nation as a whole, to ensure that GCOM conducts and supervises free and fair elections in Guyana for the benefit of all Guyanese. The party views its role as a facilitator, not as obstructionist. However, whenever and wherever the party recognizes deficiencies and shortcomings, it will highlight them, as is the case with one of the disciplined forces ballot officers, who the party has objected to ever since the May 2015 general and regional elections. Still on the question of voting by the disciplined forces, the party maintains its disappointment over the fact that the list showing the names on the disciplined forces list has not been made public nor handed to the political parties to date for scrutiny, and particularly in light of the fact that voting by the members of the disciplined forces is a mere 30 days away from today. The party rejects the view that these lists will be handed to the public on the same day of voting by members of the disciplined forces. As for the ruling APNU-AFC, which has maintained an eerie silence on the local government election process, the PPP is not oblivious to the political underpinnings of the DG-3B's campaign, as well as its so-called cabinet outreaches by the Ministry of the Presidency, in which the hapless Prime Minister, without portfolio, is encouraged to tag along with non-members of cabinet in his entourage. Whatever the role of the diplomatic community in Guyana during the local government elections, it must be in conformity with the United Nations Code of Conduct for Elections Observers and the Declaration of Principles for International Elections Observers. Thank you.
Very hard down. The statement. Now we'll open for questions.
That's one. And two, the chief elections officer said that, you know, still haven't met with GCOM officially to raise your concerns. While he's heard of your concerns, they haven't directly been communicated to GCOM.
Well, first of all, I'm happy to hear that he has heard of our concerns, which means our concerns are being heard in GCOM's quarters. But we are not only satisfied with our concerns being heard, we're concerned with our concerns. We are interested in our concern being addressed in a concrete and tangible way. So it's not only a question of hearing our concerns and, you know, dumping it by the wayside. It's also a question of implementing as best as possible after having deliberated upon them at GCOM. Then we have written to the Chairman of the Elections Commission requesting a meeting with the Commission. We've gotten a response from him inviting us to meet with him or the commission tomorrow in the afternoon. However, in light of Parliament and the sessions in respect to the budget debate, we have asked for those meetings or that particular meeting to be held in the morning rather than in the afternoon.
Is that confirmed?
The second part?
No,
it's not confirmed as yet. We've asked them to reschedule a meeting in the morning, and they've asked us for a time.
Right, and on the observers?
On the observer issue, I'm not so sure whether it's the responsibility of GCOM alone.
Right, well, that's what I'm saying. Mr. Bull kind of said there's no need for foreign observers.
Who?
Bolkan.
Bolkan? Mm-hmm. Well, Bolkan might be a voice in the wilderness on this matter. I think it matters much more higher than Bolkan. From my experience during the years in government, this is usually a matter of the office of the president. So I would expect that at some point in time, the Ministry of the Presidency will pronounce more authoritatively on this matter. I'm not so sure, as I said, whether it's for GCOM unilaterally to pronounce authoritatively on this matter without due reference to the Ministry of the Presidency. And of course, we would expect that these matters would be deliberated upon at the Commission. This is the role of the Elections Commission. How is it that individuals are just stepping out there and making statements like this without any reference to the position of the Commission? Well, then what is the role of the Commission? I am not so sure. And I doubt whether the Commission has deliberated on this matter thus far. But here we have statements being made, without due regard to the constitutional body.
Yes, 95% of...
I know you have to pick another one.
I must pick on it because it will be consistent.
Well, you know, wherever they got smoke, there's fire.
I hear you again.
Okay.
I'm not going to let you fire this morning. Mm-hmm. Your party, sir, has been looking at this entire thing as a campaign to push one race aside. You did it with the police. Did it with the army, you kept looking at the composition, and now GCOM. My first question is, how long ago did...
No, let me get back to forest parties. We're pushing what aside? What do you mean by that?
One ethnic group seems to be pushed aside in favor of another. If you're under 95% of one working, obviously you're ignoring another one.
No, what do you mean by one ethnic group being pushed aside? Which ethnic group?
Me and no, you ain't tell me which 95%.
No, but you're making a statement about the disciplined forces. You're making a statement about the police and the army.
Here, 95% of one particular ethnic group is being employed by GCOM.
Good.
To the exclusion of another ethnic group.
Okay.
And that's a charge being made by your party.
Correct.
Your party also made similar charges with respect to the police force. As far back as 92, when President Jelly Jagan talked about he can fight to get the ethnic balance in the police force, you said the same thing in the army. What is it that is influencing your party to take note of this thing? And then I'm going to ask you, which ethnic group is being predominantly employed by GCOM?
All right. In respect to the police and the other members of the discipline forces. You recall that the Discipline Forces Commission, known as the Chang Commission, had deliberated extensively on this matter. And if you to go back and read the recommendations made by the Discipline Forces Commission in the Discipline Forces Commission report, which Mr. Grange himself, when he was in the opposition, was attacking us for not implementing the recommendations. Now that he is in the government, we haven't heard a squeak. We haven't heard a squeak about efforts on their part to implement the recommendations in the Discipline Forces Commission report. Why do I make reference to that report? Because in that report, it went to the heart of the matter which is being discussed in this country, and not only in the media, in this country as a whole. The Chang report made a number of recommendations on the question of the ethnic balances in these forces. These recommendations were deliberated upon in a special select committee for years. Went to the parliament, the full house of the parliament, was adopted for implementation. And the forces themselves, under my watch, had individual meetings, brainstorming meetings, to examine each of the report, each of the recommendations in that report relevant to their sector. I think that now we have so much information coming out about money being stolen and assets being stashed away and reports being leaked. It seems as though there's dark season going on now in respect to information that could be easily garnered by the representatives of the media who wishes to get it. So I wouldn't want to go further into it. I'm saying that those reports are available, as well as the individual reports from the fire service, the prison service, the police force, as well as the Guyana Defense Force in respect to this matter. So it's not only the question of the PPP. It's this body, which Mr. Granger himself was part of, and he made those recommendations. But the question now is, the shoe is on the other foot. And what is being done about it? In respect to GCOM, this is a matter that we have been pursuing for the longest while. And we're not doing so out of any racist, racial, emotional, or prejudiced position. We are doing so on the basis of what the reality shows. It does not, the staff of GCOM does not reflect the ethnic composition of our society. We believe that efforts should be, we cannot understand how when GCOM sets exams, that one set of people are failing and another set of people are passing. We cannot understand that. How are these exams being set in such a way that only one set of people will pass and another set of people will fail? Because it is on the basis of how you perform at those exams that you are employed at GCOM. That's our position.
Which ethnic group is in this majority?
For those who have eyes to see, let them see.
Good. Next. Yes.
And what?
Headline news. What did that make up a concern to BP while it was winning the majority during the period?
Of course, it has always been. And we've always been pointing this out. But you know, the PVP can't force things on GCOM. As I said before, entrance exams are set. Interviews are set. But all these things are fixed. So there's no way in which, even though the PBP was in government, that the PBPC could have foisted on GCOM and dictated to GCOM who they should employ from who they should not. We're talking about something systemic here. We're talking about something systemic. Because had the PBP done something that people feel that we should have done, we would have been attacked and criticized for interfering in the employment practices of GCOM. So we're concerned about the systemic matters, the systemic issues, the systemic flaws in respect to the employment procedures and practices by GCOM.
So what kind of education system we have in a country that would allow one ethnic group to look at an exam paper and do well, and another ethnic group not doing well? I mean, the perception is that this exam is set so black people can pass and Indians can fail. I wonder how Douglas are people making out.
Well, that's a question you should ask Lowenfield. You should ask Lowenfield that.
Mr. Roy Kirk, Cabin News Source. A follow-up to Adam's question, I want to ask if you've done any analysis to know who are the persons applying for these jobs and positions, who are the persons...
They're refusing to give us the information. You remember one time I asked for the information and I was criticized for asking for this information. Why did I want this information, that I want this information to carry out a witch hunt?
So how do you know 95%?
Well, Chief, I said those who have eyes to see, let them use them. Madam, we all live in this country. We're not stupid people. I'm not saying this to anybody here. One of our commissioners on the nomination day, I think it was, nominations day, in addition to the other commissioners, visited a number of polling stations And he reported to the commission what he saw. It's not my business to reveal that here. But I think that at the next press conference that GCOM has, these are the kind of questions that y'all should put to GCOM. Because they're refusing to disclose basic information on which you can make a proper scientific analysis. So the information has to be guarded on the basis of empirical evidence. It has to be guarded on the basis of empirical evidence.
And as Home Affairs Minister, with the recruitment of the police force, what did you, as Home Affairs Minister, do to shift this ethnic balance in the recruitment of Ghana police force members?
My friend, I come back to the question of institutional and systemic arrangements. There's no way in which the PVPC and the Minister of Home Affairs could round up a batch of people and march them down to force headquarters at the recruitment place and demand that they be employed. The police force goes around, they set up recruitment centers just like the GDF to employ persons, but we end up with the same, as we say in local parlance, budup. We set up police training centers at Saudi. We set up a training center at Adventure on the quarantine course. Same thing. Well, I don't know if the people are going and join. I think that's something you should ask, find out what is really happening.
Next, any question?
Yes. Hi, Rodney Mira. Through the chair, and this is directed to Colonel Mostyn. Now, local government elections were held 22 years ago. Clearly, what is taking place now, based on what the GSC has said, it's not just a demographic problem, institutional problem. It is also cultural. What is being done? How is the party reacting, for example, to the specific? In some areas, people who live in one location, one address, and is listed in GCOM's NRR, is backlogs, several backlogs. So if the RO or the deputy RO doesn't have a cultural insight into that specific location, there's a danger of people being, there's a risk of people being disenfranchised. That's one. The other thing is, since May of last year, there's been at least 100 fires.
100 what?
Fires. Where households have been virtually destroyed and the person's personal documents, including especially ID cards, have been destroyed. But those persons have voted in the previous elections. Their names are in the NRR. What is being done? Has GCOM thought about the possibility of those persons turning up to vote on this occasion? They've been unwilling to do anything else. What can they do? And finding that they're not even allowed to vote. Their names are on the list, but they don't have the ID cards or destroying the file. There's been another aspect. Thieving and banditry. People have lost their belongings. So I think in addition to the factors you just enumerated, and the party has been at a length of pains to elaborate on this issue, there's this cultural problem at the grassroots level, which needs to be understood. Now, if you don't have deputy ROs or ROs who can intervene and say, well, look, let this girl or this youngster vote because I know him, then you've lost a vote. And as we've seen in the May the 15th elections, one vote makes a difference. So that's the first question. The other one,
well, let me answer the first question,
okay,
because it's been a rather lengthy one.
Yeah.
What you're going there to the nub of the matter, which has to do with impartiality of the staff, particularly at the RO, that is the returning and deputy returning officer level. Yes. This is the principle we're talking about here. The principle is that GCOM staff must be impartial and must act in a professional manner. with due regard to the manuals that are given to them and the training. They must uphold the training given to them. We have instances in this last, process date to deal with the candidates issue, where some ROs have refused to accept ID cards, where some persons have not been even asked for ID cards. And I understand that this is a matter that is stirring some interest at another level. So the question of ID cards are extremely important for use in the electoral process. Once you have an impartial official, once you have an official who, you know, is determined to act professionally, without fear or favor, affection and ill will, due process will be observed. And that is all that we're looking for. That is all that we're looking for. And in a society like ours, if you talk about the cultural aspect, it is only with those qualities you'll be able to overcome the cultural inadequacies in the society. Let's move on to the next question.
Any other, Eddie, you had another question?
Yeah, the other question I had concerned me on the precedent set by the previous commission that was set up into the Linden. Now, you were part of that system, that structure, and that commission's report was released within, let us say, a reasonable time. What's your expectation of
What report are you referring to?
Linden disturbances. Linden 2019.
Uh-huh.
What is your expectation with regards to this coalition's remit in terms of the Rodney Commission's report?
Well, I think I saw somewhere last week that the report is to be submitted this week by the commissioners. Okay? Let's... positively look forward to the report indeed being submitted. There's something that is worrying, however, that we need to take note of. Several things. One, we heard that the COI, notwithstanding the fact that it was commissioned by Cabinet, I'm talking about the COI on sugar, the COI that was commissioned on sugar, we're hearing several things. One time we heard Mr. Granger himself said that Cabinet doesn't have to accept the recommendations in the COI. He said that. They're not obliged to accept the recommendations in the COI. And then lo and behold, a few days after, I read in the newspaper where he's saying that it was Cabinet that agreed with the closure of Wales Estate. And then we heard later on that it was that decision was taken independent of what the COI recommended. That's number one. So I don't want to anticipate anything of a similar nature. Hold on a minute. You find it and you will write about it. My task is to just put up what I understand is happening. Next is, we heard that there was a COI established to look into the public service. They were to publish the report in October. Nothing has come forward as yet. Chief, they said they will complete their work in October in the advertisement. Well, that's not my business. Not my business to rationalize for them. Chief, man, look, I don't represent the government. If you represent the government, you defend them. I am not here to defend or rationalize why this happened or why this was not completed. I am simply saying that they said, this is a government speaking, and we must hold them accountable. They said that the report would be finished in October. We're waiting for the report because on the other hand, we're hearing that public servants can't get an increase until the report is published. That's number two. Number three, we heard that Cabinet had approved the establishment of a commission inquiry into the education system. Four months or 5 months after, we're hearing that the commission has not been set up as yet. What is going on? So, why I'm saying that this thing is worrying is because of the signal, the smoke signals that are emanating from the Ministry of the Presidency. You can't read them. You can't read the smoke signals. And I doubt whether the indigenous Indians who are accustomed to reading smoke signals would have been able to read them too. So I don't know, Adam. I am not getting into who know, who don't know. I'm not getting into that, man.
All right.
You could rationalize it in your ramblings in the Sunday edition of the Kaicho News.
Isn't it a tradition, sir, that the things of which you speak?
What?
Isn't it traditional that the things of which you speak just happened? For example, we set up a commission in 2011 to review facts.
If it's traditional, for who?
In this country, commissions, you announce commissions and they don't meet.
Well, you carry that to office of the Ministry of the Presidency. I know which one you're talking about.
You announce
I don't know which you're talking about.
There was
be formal. Be formal. This is not a gaffe session.
No, sir, that's why I say sir.
Yeah.
There were reports of an attack on a truck carrying home supporters in the wake of a political rally. I did deal with that matter already.
You were sitting at number three at this table.
I asked
you've now been replaced by a junior, which is a good sign.
Yes.
At the table. Now you're a backbencher.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
It's good to see that the younger journalists take any front bench.
Yeah,
that they're asserting themselves.
I haven't asked the question.
Right?
Yet, sir.
But what I'm saying, we never said we will set up a commission of inquiry into the incident which you're referring to. The police, the same gentleman, Joseph, who is now the head of the Presidential Guard, who was then the commanding Barbies, he said in the presence of the then President, Mr. Ramatar, and myself, that he will carry out investigations into the matter. We never heard anything subsequently from him or the force. Yeah. Never did.
He did report there was no attack on the bus. He did report that.
Who he reported that to?
Chief, when the media questioned him.
Who did he report that to?
I'm
was
sure
there a formal written report?
You? I wouldn't
no.
You
was
know.
There a formal written report signed off by the commander, Joseph, Brian Joseph, and endorsed, as it ought to be, by the Commissioner of Police before it leaves Force Headquarters. Do you know?
You would know. I wouldn't know, sir.
Well, I'm telling you, there was no such thing. There was
no
such thing.
So you know what happened to that thing?
Like so many things.
And you have followed up.
The elections came and went. And I'm sitting here now answering your questions. C'est la vie. You're asking a question or are you following up on Adam's question? I don't want us to engage in a gaffing session here.
I'm following up on Adam's question.
Well, could you, what's the question?
If these are your supporters.
These who?
The PPP supporters. Who are attacking.
You know about the incident?
I recall the incident.
Uh-huh.
I actually reported on it. If these are your supporters and you have their best interests at heart, why wouldn't you?
Ma'am, there's no point following up on something when you're getting nowhere. You ask questions, you write, you don't know. You ask questions, you write, but nothing comes forward.
Did you write or ask questions?
Several times.
Did that.
Several times.
All right, let's move on from that subject. Any other question? If not,
I wanted to raise a couple of issues off the statement.
Yeah.
The first thing is in respect to Zika. I'm very pleased to see that after we issued that statement on Zika, how the response has been from the Ministry of Health and the government as a whole. We're pleased to see that it took on board many of the recommendations that we made, including the involvement of PAHO in the fight against Zika. And even though sometimes we're not given credit for these recommendations that we made, in the follow-up stories, which we monitor very closely, the follow-up stories, and we noted that certain media houses don't make any reference whatsoever to what the PPP had recommended when it issued a statement on Zika. We are now seeing, I see some people scratching the beard because they know what I'm talking about. We are now seeing that many of these recommendations with the PPP advocated are being followed up on by the government. That's number one. Number two, the car crash involving Mr. Balaram Prasad. Now, I hope that the wireless link that now exists between the Demerara Harbor Bridge and the CID will give us a true picture of what really happened. Because there's now a link between the Demerara Harbor Bridge and the CID, which gives to the CID all the movements that take place on the Demerara Harbor Bridge. There was a big photograph in the newspaper some weeks ago of shaking hands and back slapping and, you know, everybody rock and rolling with each other that we now have this thing in place and, you know, glory, hallelujah. Well, now is the time. Now we have a good occasion to really tell us what took place in that bridge, because I am concerned. Nothing is clear as to what really happened. I'm hearing things about blowout, and I'm hearing all kind of different things. I don't know if the man was shot at, or if his tire was shot at, but the footage, and I'm insisting that the footage ought to be shown on the local television and must be given to the media houses as well, as is done in America, where these things are disclosed. Now, you know Mr. Balaram Prasad was supposed to be the number two. And right now, there's a toss-up in the hierarchy, which you, Adam, know, and which your policeman at the, your police watcher at Kai Chiu News. I'm surprised that he hasn't called me as yet. What's his name?
Dale Andrews.
I'm sure he has information, probably more than we do. But I'm saying that there ought to be no mystery surrounding this incident. The footage must be revealed, and people must see. We don't only want to see, like we saw in today's Chronicle, a car crash up, a line in a corner. We want to see the movement of actually what took place second by second with this vehicle.
Well, it wasn't on the bridge or in the vicinity of the bridge.
Comrade. There is a report that the incident took place on the bridge. Comrade, don't tell me no. If there's no, don't contest it here. Contest it in your news release. There is a report that the incident took place on the bridge. There's another report that it took place on the vicinity of the bridge, wherever. I am saying that there's CCTV coverage, and the information is being withheld about what really happened, in the same way as information is being held with respect to the pile accident. Now, I feel very disappointed. So that's one. I feel very disappointed that incident involving the GDF rank had been reduced to accident. And now they've asked the traffic chief to investigate the matter. But I don't know as yet if the traffic chief has written a report to Mr. Ramjetan. But I don't think it would take as long as we're seeing now for such a report to be submitted to Mr. Ramjetan. Next, we haven't heard anything about who is the second driver in the second vehicle. And more than that, whether the vehicle which Pyle crashed, that regrettably cost the life of himself and wife, that the owner for that vehicle is going to be compensated. This is the type of things that journalists must investigate. But, you know, I don't want to be critical of anybody in this room, but sometimes journalists have a propensity to leave things like that. But they don't investigate it. What they investigate is anything that can embarrass the PPP. Anything that is that could embarrass the PPP, trust me, they will dig and dig and dig till the fingernails even break.
Well, I'm a backbencher, so again.
Now, the next thing is Ramjetan said that he's waiting on a report and the coroner's inquest to be established in respect to the same matter. Well, we just passed a bill in Parliament in respect to the question of coroners, setting up of coroner's inquest. We don't know as yet if the president has assented to that bill so that it could become law, so that this coroner's inquest could be set up speedily, because we heard from Mr. Basil Williams that they have a shortage of coroners. And one of the reasons for this bill was to be able to recruit more coroners. Well, we don't know whether we have to wait until that bill is assented to by the president so he can get some additional coroners, or whether he could use some of the magistrates now who are already complaining that they have such a great backlog of work to do this coroner's thing. So it looks as though we can wait until Thy Kingdom come to hear from Mr. Ramjetan what really transpired in respect to Mr. Pyle's demise. The deportee issue. This deportee issue is a serious matter. I noticed that the U.S. ambassador stated that the number of deportees have reduced. Well, what do we compare that with? How do we make the comparative analysis? The gentleman may very well be given facts, but I'm saying that facts looked at in isolation from the totality of the number of deportees coming back to this country is meaningless. It's meaningless. Now, Mr. Harmon had said in September 2013 that the government should have programs to facilitate the reintegration of deportees. He belonged to a defunct organization. I think he was the head of that organization called the Junkata Juvant Friendly Society. The Junkata Juvant Friendly Society. Harmon was the head of that. But it closed its doors in 2011. And while he was head of that organization, this was an organization that received some funding from the French government because it was dealing with deportees coming back mainly from French Guiana. And he made some very sweeping statements at that time, pointing to the PVPC government, of course, that we did not have programs and policies in place to deal with deportees. Well, Mr. Harmon is now in the government. He's the number two. The de facto number two to Mr. Granger. Don't worry with others who are pampersetting about the number two. Right? Don't worry with others who are pampersetting as number two. Maybe it's number two that we spoke about when we were children going to the backyard. That kind of number two. But I'm saying that the number two at the office of the president must tell us what is happening now in Guyana in respect to the deportee issue. And I would like to see his response to the U.S. ambassador on this question. He must respond to this question. Ladies and gentlemen, that's all for now. The rest, stay tuned until you hear from me in Parliament.